Good afternoon. As some of you know, College of Computing is in the midst of a year of celebrations. We're celebrating 25 years as a college and 50 years for computing at Georgia Tech. So it's really a great pleasure to introduce Vint Cerf as a keynote speaker of also the Marconi Fellows Symposium. But as a guest speaker. So the way he got here was that several months ago I was asked to host the Marconi Society, a board meeting here. By the way, the chair, maybe you stand up. David Payne from Southampton in the UK, not in Pennsylvania. So I agreed under one condition. That Vint will give a talk and Henry Samueli will give a talk. Vint immediately agreed, so I agreed. Henry tentatively agreed, but his kids have spring break, so he couldn't make it. But that's good enough. So Vint needs no introduction, you know. But I'll say a few words about him. First, you know, he is the second evangelist in the history of mankind. The first was John 2,000 years ago, and he's now the evangelist for internet evangelist for Google. Vint essentially won almost all the prizes, so it's easy to say which prizes he didn't win. So I don't think he won the Nobel Prize simply because there are no Nobel Prizes in the fields he is working on. But he won the Marconi Prize, which is a Nobel Prize of Telecommunications, which the Marconi Society awards. And he won the ACM Award, a Turing Award, which is a Nobel Prize in Computer Science. So I guess everybody here knows that he's co-designer of the TCP/IP protocols and the architecture of the Internet. He's considered a co-creator of the ARPANET, the Internet predecessor, co-creator together with Bob Kahn. As vice president of MCI Digital Information Services from 1982 to 1986, he led the engineering of MCI Mail, the first commercial email service to be connected to the internet. In December of 1997, President Bill Clinton presented the US National Medal of Technology to Vint, together with Bob Kahn, for founding and developing the internet. He won the Turing Award in 2004, Presidential Medal of Freedom from George Bush. So he doesn't differentiate or discriminate about parties. You know, you'll get an award from every president. He served from 2000 to 2007 as chairman of the board of the Internet, and he helped to form the Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. That's the organization that give names for internet sites. He served as founding president of Internet Society, 1992 to 95, and in 1999 he served as a chairman of the board, and since 2005 he served as vice president and chief internet evangelist for Google. In his role, he's responsible for identifying new enabling technologies to support development of advanced internet-based products and services. He's also an active public face for Google in the internet world. So please welcome Vint Cerf.
I hope this is working. Let's see. Am I audible? No. Hang on. How's that?
That's all. Okay, we seem to be working all right. Can we crank it down a little? Even I can hear the echo. Well, first of all, it's a real pleasure to be here. It's the first time I've actually had a chance to spend more than a moment or two on the campus, and we still haven't seen enough of it, so as V, I'll be back. You can't get rid of me this easy. Second, the topic is about the explosion of the internet and the additional devices that are showing up on it. We already had a chance to see some of the robotics laboratory this morning or early this afternoon. And this is indicative of what we'll call cyber-physical systems. This is an increase in the number of devices that are showing up that are programmable, that have communications capability, and maybe interacting with each other through a variety of networks, not exclusively the internet. So I'd like to explore that topic with you by first going back into history. So let's go back to 1969. I was a graduate student, like many of you, at UCLA, where the first ARPANET packet switch was installed. This was an experiment that the Defense Department sponsored starting in 1968, actually. A packet switch was built by a company called Bolt, Baranek, and Newman. The first one was installed at UCLA. Three others were installed, as you see on this chart. So we had this little four-node network, and we were experimenting with getting computers to talk to each other using packet switch technology. This is what the packet switch looked like. It was the size of a refrigerator. It was delivered in a very heavy metal container because Bolt, Baranek, and Newman, which is building this thing, knew that it was being delivered into a highly hostile environment, a university where there were students, and graduate students and undergraduates in 69, actually, with the first delivery in September. I think they were thinking it was being built for the military, and so maybe they would, you know, put it in place from a helicopter. But I think the real answer was they were worried that there would be graduate students around. Anyway, that's what packet switch looked like way back in 69. The first actual demonstration of a three-network didn't come until 1977. Bob Kahn and I wrote the first designs for the internet in 1973. It took us a fair amount of time and a lot of help to get to the point where the protocols looked like they were fairly solid. And in order to prove it to ourselves, we implemented the TCP/IP protocols on a mobile packet radio network and a packet satellite network in addition to the ARPANET. By this time, 1977, the ARPANET had grown to something like 30 or 40 nodes. The packet radio system was in operation in the San Francisco Bay Area, and the satellite connected the eastern part of the United States with the western part of Europe by way of ground stations in the UK, Norway, and then later Italy and Germany. So we actually had the packet radio van running up and down the Bayshore Freeway, radiating packets that were carried through gateways. We didn't know they were supposed to be called routers, so we called them gateways, going across the ARPANET through an internal satellite link to Norway, down to London at University College London, out of the London facility into another ground station, up over the packet satellite network, back to Etam, West Virginia in the US, and then through another gateway into the ARPANET again and all the way across the country to USC Information Sciences Institute. Now, if you do the math, the distance from the packet radio van to USC Information Sciences Institute was 400 miles. But the packets traveled about 100,000 miles because they went over two satellite hops through synchronous satellites and back and forth across the Atlantic in the US. But it actually worked. And I remember, you know, thinking, holy cow, it actually works. Sort of like, it's a miracle when any software works, and so I was pretty excited about that. This was the first convincing demo that you could build a protocol and implement it on multiple types of networks and have it actually function. So this is what the internet looks like now, of course. It's a much larger system. There are hundreds of thousands of networks that are interconnected to each other. Each of those networks is run autonomously, and I think this is an important aspect of internet's design. It's very distributed. The people who run the networks have different business models. They make their choices about what software and hardware to run. They choose with whom to interconnect. It's not centrally controlled at all. The only element of centrality at all is the allocation of internet addresses from a central facility, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, and this is simply to assure uniqueness. You don't want to hand out the same internet address to two different parties or three different parties. The same thing is true of domain names, and so the root zone of the domain name system is managed by the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, but there are hundreds, and now there will be several, almost 2,000 top-level domains. There will be operators, registries for each one of those top-level domains. ICANN does not operate them. They just point to them, and those are hierarchically distributed, as I'm sure most of you know. So this is what the internet looks like today with about 3 billion users. In fact, the numbers are probably bigger than this because there are an awful lot of people now who are using mobile smartphones to get access to the internet. And it isn't quite clear to me how these statistics are getting generated. The ITU produced the estimates for the number of users on the net, but I don't know if they're counting smartphones. And there's clearly an overlap between people who have laptops and tablets and also have smartphones. But it's certain that the next billion users on the net will probably experience the internet first through mobile. And that's one of the reasons that mobile has become such an important element of the internet story. Now, I need to go back for just a moment to remind you of where those mobiles came from. Last year, we honored Marty Cooper as another Marconi Award winner. He was the inventor of the handheld mobile phone. His invention began in 1973, the same year that Bob Kahn and I started doing the design of the internet, only we didn't know anything about each other. He was at Motorola, Bob and I were here in the US. I was at Stanford and he was at the Defense Department. So Marty finally got his system running. He tested it, demonstrated it in 73, but he didn't actually have an operational system until 1983. Ironically, that's the year we turned the internet on. And so that was the year I actually met Marty. I didn't meet him face to face. One of my colleagues invited me to lunch and said, I have something to show you. So I went to lunch and he has his thing sitting on the table. It's about that tall with a whip antenna on the top and it weighs about 3.5 pounds. I said, what's that? He said, it's a phone. And I said, where's the wire? And he says, there isn't any, it's a handheld phone. So I started asking him questions about how it worked. And finally he said, you know, I don't know the answer to all those questions. Why don't you call the guy that invented it? So I called Marty on the handheld phone and we talked to each other about how it worked. So that was 1983. And what's happened now, 20 years later, is that the mobile phone, the smartphone in particular, and the internet have merged together in a mutually reinforcing way. The mobile makes the internet more useful because you can get to it whenever you want to, and the internet makes the mobile more useful because of all the content and computing capability that's buried in the internet. So the next thing, of course, that's happening is that all kinds of devices are showing up on the net. Some of these have been around for a while, but I confess to you that during the 40-year period I've been associated with the internet's evolution, it did not occur to me in the early stages that refrigerators would be on the internet, or picture frames, or light bulbs. I actually used to tell jokes saying, you know, someday every light bulb will have its own IP address. I can't tell jokes about that anymore because Philips makes the Hue bulb, which you can control from your mobile and change the intensity and also the color of the bulb. The one I like the most is the guy in the middle. This is the internet-enabled surfboard. I've never met this guy. He's Dutch. But I have this image of him sitting on the water, you know, waiting for the next wave, thinking, you know, if I had a laptop in my surfboard, I could be surfing the internet while I'm waiting for the next wave. So he puts a Wi-Fi service back at the rescue shack, and then he goes off on the water and he surfs the internet until the next wave comes along. So if you're interested in that, that's a product. So you should go Google that, and maybe you can buy one and use it. Of course, then there's Google Glass down here. That's modeled by Sergey Brin, co-founder of Google. What's interesting about Google Glass, from my point of view, is that it's an opportunity to bring the computers into the normal interactive environment that humans experience. Your robotics laboratory is exploring exactly that same kind of space. In this case, you have a computer that can see what you're seeing, and it can hear what you're hearing. So it's there's the potential for it to be a partner in a conversation as opposed to simply a tool. So I have this fantasy, this doesn't work right now, but I'm imagining that there is a blind German speaker and a deaf sign language speaker, and they're both wearing Google Glass and they're trying to communicate with each other. So just imagine what happens. The blind German speaker says, Guten Nachmittag, ich heiße Vint Cerf. You know, good afternoon, my name is Vint Cerf. Now, the deaf guy doesn't hear a thing, but his Google Glass microphone picks up the sound, transforms it into text, and displays the text on the little display up in the upper right. Now, the deaf guy responds by signing. Of course, the blind guy doesn't see the signing, but the camera on the Google Glass sees the signing, translates the signing into text, translates the text, English text, into German, and then speaks the German in the bone conduction speaker of the Google Glass, and the two of them are now communicating. What's interesting is that we can almost do that. We can do every bit of that except for the part about actually recognizing signs, and I've been told that this is not impossible, that it's a serious engineering possibility. So the idea of bringing computers into our normal human interactive environment strikes me as being a very attractive thing, and that's partly what this Google, or what this Internet of Things is going to be all about. Here's another example
Sensor networks are certain to be a part of the internet environment. I'm running a commercial. This is not me in the garage with a soldering gun. This is a commercial sensor network. It's running IPv6. Each of the sensors is about the size of a mobile, but it runs on 2 AA batteries for almost a year. Each sensor is a radio that can handle store and forward. It builds the network automatically. So the radio senses their connectivity and maintain this ad hoc network. Each 5 minutes, they're sampling temperature, humidity, and light levels in the house. And they send that data to a server that's down in my basement. So at the end of the year, I have good engineering information about how well the heating, ventilation, and air conditioning have done. I know only a geek would do that, but the whole point here is that we can engineer buildings to know much more about how well they are functioning using techniques like this. Now, one room in the house is the wine cellar. And that room needs to stay below 60 degrees Fahrenheit and preferably above 40% humidity to keep the corks from drying out. So that room has been alarmed. If the temperature goes above 60 degrees Fahrenheit, I get an SMS on my mobile. And that's happened a few times. And then I began thinking, I can actually tell while I'm away if somebody's gone into the wine cellar because I could see that the lights went off and on. But I don't know what they did in there. So my next project is to put an RFID detector in the wine cellar, and I've actually acquired one from a startup company, and you hang RFID tags on the bottles, so I can do instantaneous inventory even when I'm not at home, and I can be able to tell if any bottles have left the wine cellar without my permission. So I was describing this design to one of my engineer friends, and he said, "You have a bug in the design." I said, "What do you mean I have a bug?" And he says, "Well, you could go into the wine cellar and drink the wine and leave the bottle there." So now we have to put sensors in the cork. And if you're going to do that, you might as well put sensors in there that can sample the esters that give the flavor to the wine. So before you open the bottle, you interrogate the cork. And if that's the bottle that got up to 80 degrees because the cooling system failed, that's the bottle you give to somebody who doesn't know the difference. So this is a very practical thing to have around the house. Truly, we will see sensors of this kind throughout our environment as time goes on. So you can imagine this Internet of Things having lots and lots of devices like this. Now, there are some issues associated with this kind of thing. Here's all these various things that are going on in the Internet today. There are an endless number of applications. Part of the reason being that the Internet is so open and the architecture is so flexible that people can invent new ways of using it. The network itself doesn't have any idea what the applications are. The packets are kind of like postcards. The postcard doesn't know what you wrote on it. And the internet packets don't know what they're carrying. All they know is they're moving bits from one place to another, which means if you want to invent a new application, it's a question of software at the edges of the net interpreting those bits, as opposed to the network doing anything or knowing anything about the applications. So that's why you begin to see all these kinds of possibilities. Now, being speeding up here so that I can make sure we get done in 2:15 and still have time for some Q&A. This one is just to draw your attention to the fact that it isn't all engineering. Internet has become so visible and so important in many ways that many governments are very concerned about how it works, how it's used, what people can do with it, what abuses can be undertaken through it. And the consequence of that is a great deal of debate about what's called governance of the internet. Now, there's governance of the technology, and that's largely a question of standards making. That's participated in by the Internet Engineering Task Force, by IEEE with its local area network standards, by ITUT and ITUR and others. But that's just the technical side. There's this question of who can use the network, how can they use it, how is it supplied to users, how do we protect users from abuse, what do we do about malware, what do we do about people who have bugs in their software that can be exploited as vulnerabilities. So there are a number of things that have to be dealt with, not the least of which is privacy and safety and security. And on the safety side, I'd like to emphasize something. We frequently use the word security when we're really speaking of safety. So let me give you an example. I think we need a cyber fire department. Let me explain what I mean by that. There are lots and lots of small companies, plus you and me, who are not in a position to really manage the safety and security of the software that we rely on. So imagine if you're a small business and you're under cyber attack, it would be nice to have some place to call for help.
So let's pretend that the place you call is the cyber fire department. Their job is to come out and put out the cyber fire. Now, the analogy is not perfect, but it's very typical that if the house is on fire, you don't call the police department. You call the fire department that has a bigger hose and more water. They put out the fire. Then they look to see how the fire got started. And if it turns out that it was started deliberately, now the police get involved because it might be a question of arson. Now, this metaphor has some flaws in it. For example, if your neighbor's house is on fire, it's okay for you to call the fire department because the house fire is a hazard to the rest of the neighborhood. And so when the fire department shows up, they are free to break in the roof and the windows and pour a lot of water in the house and maybe ruin a whole lot of your possessions to put out the fire because the fire is the hazard. Now imagine a different scenario in the cyber space. Let's take the two of you. You're running company A and you're running company B. Okay, so, and there's a cyber fire department. So company B calls the cyber fire department and says, company A is under attack. So the cyber fire department over here runs over to company A and basically shuts down the operation, tries to figure out what the problem is for several days. Meanwhile, company B is eating his lunch, right? Because he's called the cyber fire department to keep company A from functioning. The rules probably have to be different for the cyber fire department. Company A has to realize it's under attack, or if company B is friendly and says, hey, I think you're under attack, and company A says, holy cow, you're right, you should call the cyber fire department so the fire department doesn't come and put you out of business the way company B wanted you to. I'm sure neither of you would ever do that. So these kinds of metaphors you have to be very careful with, but I do think that we should experiment with this notion of a cyber fire department. It's not the same as, you know, national security. And the problem with a lot of the words we use is that we sometimes conflate things that should be more about safety with national security, national attacks, national scale responses. So on that score, just think about the possibility of responding to a serious denial of service attack. Let's suppose that a bank, the worst case scenario is the one where Bank of America is under attack by 100,000 refrigerators. That's my big, you know, I'm worried about that particular headline. And the problem here is that the computer that's being used to run this internet-enabled refrigerator is actually a fairly powerful computer. It's hard to buy a weak computer these days. I mean, they're all capable of having a lot of memory and everything else. Even if a very simple operating system was running the application that manages the refrigerator, if somebody manages to get access to that and downloads Linux or something, he's got a very powerful engine. So you can imagine, you know, people abusing 100,000 or 100 million refrigerators. What I worry about is that we not have a knee-jerk reaction to launch a response without understanding and having good attribution of the origin of the attack. If it were your laptops and my laptops that have become infected and were targeting a particular, maybe it's a financial institution, the last thing you would want is for that financial institution to launch a counterattack which wipes out everybody's disk drives. The problem there is that you don't know that your machine was infected. You're innocent of all this. It's just that you happen to be the instrument through which the attack was being run by the botnet general. And so the real problem is finding and finding solid attribution to who is running the attack, not just the devices that are being used. So just to draw one other thing to your attention, most of the reason that we have these problems in vulnerability is that our software stinks. It has bugs. And, you know, we haven't figured out how to write bug-free software. Despite the rapid development of hardware capability, we haven't shown very much improvement in our ability to write software that's bug-free. And so if any of you are looking for really tough dissertation topics, finding a way to devise environments that will allow you to make assertions about the code and have that environment tell you whether or not that assertion can be supported would be very helpful. This is not the same as proofs of correctness, which have not turned out to be very helpful. When you think about maybe doing a simple computation, you could make an assertion about whether the computation is correctly executed by the software. But what's a proper operation statement in first order logic for a finance system or a banking system or a video game. It's not clear how you would ever write that, let alone how you would do a proof. But if you had a system that allowed you to make assertions, which if true, would give you much more confidence that the software does not have vulnerabilities of certain kinds, like buffer overflow and things like that, that would be a good thing. So better software environments for building less buggy software would be a really powerful contribution. One other thing on hardware reinforced security. Back in the 60s, there was a project called Multi-Access Computing, Project MAC, at MIT. They modified a Honeywell 635 to turn it into a Honeywell 645, and it had basically virtual memory, which was a new idea back then, and it had 8 rings of protection. What that meant was that unless you were in the right ring, you weren't allowed to execute certain sensitive instructions. Basically, if you executed one of those sensitive instructions, you'd be trapped down to the kernel, and the kernel would say, who are you, and why do you think you're allowed to execute this instruction? This might be an instruction that would write into the operating system, for example, or some other privileged instruction. So the whole idea was to get the hardware to help you reinforce security of the system. The x86 chips that we have still have those rings of protection in them, but nobody's writing any software for it. So my suggestion is we should be paying attention to reinforcing our security concepts in software with the hardware and have it work in concert with us. So I want to skip to a different topic now and then finish up. This has to do with the problem of digital preservation. Now, we've been talking about the Internet of Things and all of the control and complexity associated with that, but I also want to draw your attention to what I've been calling the digital dark age. We all create large quantities of digital content, and we store it away in a variety of different physical media. Well, that's not new. We've had media around for long periods of time, like baked tablets written in cuneiform from the Assyrian period, which got baked because there was a fire, for example. Sometimes they didn't do that on purpose. But these things have lasted for several thousand years. The same thing could be said for vellum, which is made with sheepskin or calfskin. Those documents last for at least 1,000 years or more. And if you've ever seen some of the ones that are illuminated, they're beautiful. You can still read them if you can still read the Greek or the Latin that they might have been written in. So these are long-lived materials. And we create documents today, for example, videos or photographs or text documents and things like that. These are all static things. Now, I realize a movie doesn't seem like it's static, but it really, the file doesn't change. It's just a file that gets interpreted frame by frame by frame. So for all practical purposes, it's still a static image. So these are all ways in which static material has been saved over time. But what about the way in which we store digital content? Some of you may still have 5 1/4 inch floppy disks. Some of you may have 3 1/2 inch floppy disks. Some of you may have DVDs and CD-ROMs. Have you noticed that the readers for those don't seem to be readily available anymore? Have you noticed that Apple didn't neglect it to put a DVD reader in some of its latest MacBook Pros or MacBook Airs? I still have VHS tapes floating around, and I kept one VHF reader in the possibility that I'll be able to translate that over into another medium. So there are two issues here. The media themselves may not last very long in terms of just like the VHS tapes eventually become read once because the oxide comes right off the backing. Or the reader isn't available anymore. So let's pretend for the sake of this argument that in fact we actually move the bits from one medium to another in a timely way so that we actually have kept copies of the bits. So then we're done, right? We just make sure we copy them into media that are current. Well, let's imagine it's the year 3000, and you've just done a Google search, and you've turned up a 1997 PowerPoint file. Let's imagine you're running Windows 3000, and the question is whether Office 3000 knows how to read a 1,000-year-old PowerPoint file. Now, the answer is probably no, and this is not a gratuitous dig at Microsoft. Even if we were using open source software, to have it survive for 1,000 years and be able to read 1,000-year-old format files is still kind of a tough question. So there's a solution to this, and that is to emulate the hardware that used to run the operating systems that ran the applications, and to build these emulators so you could run them on any machine that could run essentially a virtual machine environment. You could run this in a standalone machine. You could imagine running virtual machines in a cloud environment, which is happening now already on a commercial basis. So the interesting possibility here is to build up an archive of operating systems and applications and machine descriptions, and then use that to recreate the environment in which the older software runs and in which these older file formats can be interpreted. So there are a bunch of challenges, which I really don't have time to go into because I want to leave a little time for Q&A. But the thing I want to draw your attention to is this is not just a technical problem. There are questions about intellectual property. For example, who owns the software that you're trying to hold onto for hundreds or thousands of years? We don't exactly have rules that say when does that expire. Well, there are patents and there's copyright. And at some point in the far future, I guess the copyright says that the corporations that create something that's copywritten have to turn it into the public domain after 75 years after the creation of the, after the death of the author, or I guess, I don't know how it works with corporations. Somebody here probably knows, but it's at least 75 years or more. So the real issue here is how do you get control over the software before one of those expiration points? What if a company goes out of business and you have relied on their software to make a whole bunch of digital objects that you'd like to continue using? The problem is, if you ask them for the software, the bankruptcy judge will say, no, that's an asset and you can't have it. Or you ask for a digital, just an object code version, and they may refuse that. Or maybe they just say, I'm not going to support that software anymore. There might be good business reasons for just not doing that, like Internet Explorer, I guess, is now going to be not serviced anymore. So the problem we all have is finding a way to preserve our ability to correctly interpret the bits, even if we manage to save the bits using careful media. So there's a lot of work going on, and I just want to draw your attention to something at CMU called Project Olive. They basically start with a Linux engine. They put a virtual machine on top of that. They run the old operating systems inside the virtual machine. Then they run the application on top of that. And then they emulate. This is not very visible, is it? Wow. I don't know what to make of that. Well, the easy solution here is that what they've done is they've wrapped up this entire environment into something which looks like the web, and so they can interact with the older files that are sitting out on servers that are in the World Wide Web. So what this allows you to do is emulate the older software and pull the files from the World Wide Web if they've been stored out there. So if you know about Brewster Kahle and the Wayback Machine and his Internet Archive, this is a way of instantiating the ability to look at older files. And this could be repeated over long periods of time as long as you are able to retain the hardware descriptions and the digital object code that the operating system and the applications need. So that's sort of that's the last slide in this deck. I just wanted to remind you that if we don't do something about this, that we will become a digital black hole, that our colleagues in the future, the 22nd century, won't know very much about the 21st century because all the email and the blogs and the web pages and everything else won't be interpretable anymore. And so we will just disappear. And that's not a good thing because, you know, any society that forgets its past is doomed, and we don't want to be that. So somebody needs to work on this. And some of you have some ideas for making this self-supporting thing, right? Because this has got to last for hundreds of thousands of years. That's a really hard problem. So thank you for letting me chew up some of your afternoon. I'm happy to answer a few questions, and then we need to go on to the other panel. But thanks very much for your time. Okay, so we got, yes, if there are questions. If there aren't, it's okay. That works, yes. There he is. Yes, sir.
So you were talking about breaches for companies and all this kind of stuff. And I think one of the bigger problems there is people underestimate like how bad it actually is. And you only see when something big explodes at Sony. Right. So how can we get companies that don't want to admit that they've been hacked, but either incentivize or force them to admit that they've been hacked so we can like actually start dealing with this problem?
Yeah, there are two answers to that question. One is to, by example, report problems, and we do that at Google. We've taken the view that we should tell people
what bad things have happened, and to say, to some extent, what we've done to respond. Like two-factor authentication was one of our responses, encrypting all of the traffic going between the data centers, at rest on the data centers, in the laptops, has all been part of our response. I think, though, that you've touched on a really important point, which is incentives. And usually, the only way you can get something different to happen is to figure out what incentives are driving the current behavior and to find different incentives that will drive a different behavior. So this could be carrot or stick. Maybe the stick is needed here. Maybe the idea that you didn't tell anybody about a penetration is, in fact, a costly mistake. Now, you'll notice that the Congress has made requirements on some of the businesses that if they are penetrated and the number of people affected is bigger than some number, they must report it to the Congress. It would be nice, though, if we could also provide some positive incentives for that, which is why the notion of cyber insurance is now starting to get some interesting play. You can imagine a company saying, well, I know that I'm going to be potentially liable in the event that my security systems fail. I'm going to buy cybersecurity insurance. The insurance company is trying to figure out, okay, how well have they equipped themselves to defend against this possible outcome? If they can show the insurance company that they are well defended, the premiums would be lower. If they can't, the premiums would be higher. So what I would not want as an outcome, though, is that a company decides it just buys insurance and pays no attention to building better security and safety into their systems. So we still need to find strong incentives. I've often thought public shaming might be, you know, one way to do that. Thank you. That was a good question. Others? Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned about hardware-based security. A lot of hardware out there is already being used, so it's hard to upgrade it to new hardware-based security. So what do you make of hacking at the hardware level?
Okay, so that's a good question. In fact, there are two problems that you imply. The first problem is that if you really need a hardware upgrade, you need a hardware upgrade, and how do you provide incentives for people to do that? We used to think that routers, you know, home routers are particularly crappy, and we thought that we could have some kind of a program where you could turn in your crappy router and get a better one and have a discount or something like that. On the software side, though, it's even more critical. When you think about the Internet of Things, and these are, you know, refrigerators and appliances, they don't have liquid crystal displays, they don't have simple controls that you could use, and yet their software probably needs to be updated. Now this gets really tricky because you want it to be legitimate software that upgrades it, not the hacker down the street who, or around the world, who is updating your refrigerator. So figuring out how to strongly authenticate the sources of software is going to turn out to be really important. Now, this gets now to public key cryptography and the powerful tool for digitally signing things, except now we have quantum computing coming along, which is going to mess up the work factor for a lot of the crypto schemes that are dependent on the difficulty of factoring the products of large primes. So now we're going to have to find some new crypto algorithms that are not dependent on that particular work factor. I guarantee you there are several places here in the US that are intensely interested in that. One of them is you, I see. No, okay, so good. I mean, I hope you come up with something successful because we're going to need it. I'm sorry? Yes. So, you know, the quantum computing is still in its early stages, but even Google is starting to explore that, not because we're trying to crack codes, but because we're trying to get speed up in the algorithms that we run for optimization. I think I'm going to stop there and allow time to turn this over to the next panel, if that's okay. Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Okay, it turns out that there's a decision about the best presentations in the posters, and I know you've been waiting for this. Okay, here we go. Let's see, there are two of them, is that correct?
Yeah.
Yes, best presentation and best futuristic idea. You can hang on to that. Apparently, I'm still wired. All right, so best presentation. Could I have Yongjin Yang and help? The security overlay, transparent end-to-end encryption for messaging apps. Come on up here. That's the best presentation. Congratulations.
This is given for solving an extremely important problem of security on messaging apps.
And this one I got to see twice today because they came in and showed us the Marconi board. The second one is the best futuristic idea. This is for thinking outside of the box. And it's Bhavana Krishnaswamy, time-elapsed communication, bacterial communication on a microfluidic chip. There she is. Thank you so much. Congratulations. So just to say something about Bhavana's work, there's a woman who is on the National Science Board. His name is Bonnie Bassler. She's at Princeton University, and she's among the few people who realized some time back that bacteria use these molecules for signaling. And what I find so interesting about it is that the bacteria are detecting the intensity of the signals. This is a broadcast signal, and the bacteria are reacting to the intensity and presence of those molecules. The reason I bring it up in this context is that I've always wanted to do broadcast internet protocols where you could just broadcast this stuff to everybody, and anybody that picks it up begins to get some sense for what's going on in the environment. So it's not targeted point-to-point communication. It's more a broadcast, which is exactly the way the bacteria are working. So thank you for letting me do that. And now I guess, who am I going to turn this over to for the next panel? So, attenzione, Hattie, our panel is ready.
And just one more announcement. All the other presenters will get gift cards. Contact Yasin afterwards and you will get gift cards. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. So let me introduce Hattie Hamlin, who is the executive director of the Marconi Society, who has organized the panel coming up next. Hattie.
I hope you'll stay for the panel on women in technology and some of the real-world challenges and issues that they face. Two of our local professors will be on the panel, along with Vint and Akanksha Chowdhury, who we've just met, who's one of our she's one of our Marconi Young Scholars, who's a Microsoft researcher. So we'll be setting this up in just 2 seconds, and we'll get going.
Okay, so we should all go over here.
Just be passing fences, and then time may go.
Yeah.
Our love is here to stay. Together we're going on a long, long way. In time, the rockets may crumble, Gibraltar may tumble. They only made of clay. Our love is here to stay.
It's very clear our love is here to stay. Not for a year, but ever and a day. Just be passing fancies, and in time may go. But no, my dear, our love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. In time the Rockies may Gibraltar may tumble, they're only made of clay, but our love is here to stay. Thank you. Gibraltar may crumble, they're only made of clay. But forever and a day, our love is here to stay.
Two, three, four. What? We're going to pass it around.
Okay. Oh, you don't know us.
We can share the microphone.
I love the gender balance at this table. Right.
Shows you what it feels like, doesn't it?
Actually, I like this. I mean, I'm not complaining at all.
So gender balance and technology has been in the news quite a bit recently. The Ellen Powd verdict just came down, and as one technology reporter said, it was the right time and the wrong case for making the case for gender bias in technology. Google led the way with the release of its numbers on technology, women in technology-related jobs at Google. So it's time to talk about what are those issues and problems that are faced by women in technology. We have a blue ribbon panel here. Vint, you've already probably met. If you haven't, he's the Vice President and Chief Internet Evangelist at Google. He has a distinguished career having worked in a variety of industries, or not industries, but at least companies, including IBM, which I think was actually a leader in gender equality in technology, MCI, DARPA, which probably was not a leader in gender equality, and Google. He's widely known as the father of the internet, or a father of the internet, having invented TCP/IP, co-invented it with Bob Kahn. Dana Randall, you may know. She is the advanced professor of computing here at Georgia Tech, and I love this, the director of the Algorithms and Randomness Center at Georgia Tech. I want to work at a randomness center. She is a fellow of the American Mathematical Society, a national associate of the National Academies, and holds degrees in computer science and mathematics from Harvard University and UC Berkeley. Her research focuses on randomized algorithms and sampling and has helped to create an interdisciplinary field bridging computer science, discrete probability, and statistical physics. She served most recently on the Board of Governors of the Institute for Mathematics and its Applications, the Executive Board of DIMAX, the Editorial Board of AMS, and the Steering Committee for the ACM Symposium on Discrete Algorithms. Okay. Ellen Zagora received both her undergraduate and graduate degrees at Washington University in St. Louis. Since 1993, she's been on the faculty of the College of Computing at Georgia Tech. She's conducted research and taught in computer networking for over 20 years. Her research interests include the internet with a focus on its topological structure and services, and mobile wireless computing and networking. In 2008, she helped create the Computing for Good initiative of the College of Computing, a project-based teaching and research activity that focuses on the use of computing to solve pressing societal problems. She's a fellow of the IEEE, a fellow of the ACM, and an elected member of the Computing Research Association Board. She served on the NSF, CISE Advisory Committee from 2005 to 2009. And Dr. Akanksha Chowdhury is a postdoctoral researcher at Microsoft in the Mobility and Networking Group, Microsoft Research. She completed her MS and her PhD in electrical engineering at Stanford University. And I'm happy to say she was our first Paul Barron Young Scholar at the Marconi Society. So she's been breaking new ground all along the way. In her time at Stanford, she received the Young Mai Ju Stanford School of Engineering Fellowship, the Stanford's Diversifying Academia Recruiting Excellence, called DARE, fellowship, and she completed her bachelor's degree in India at their very excellent IIT Delhi. So we have a blue ribbon panel here, and I'm just going to start it off with a couple of things to discuss among the panelists. Technology companies sometimes say that women just aren't getting ahead in the industry because they don't have enough STEM skills. Is it true? And if so, what can we do about it? So, Vint, you want to start?
I don't think I should.
I don't think you should.
I think it's entirely inappropriate for a male to start this discussion. Besides, what you would get would be some, you know, I would scratch my head and say, I don't understand what the problem is. And the other ladies would look at me and say, that's the problem. So we should start with one of the three of you. And since you're nearest, why don't we hand this to you? Do you mind?
No, not at all.
So addressing your question at a broader level, the STEM pipeline has been shrinking in some sense, getting middle school or high school students, girls especially excited about science and engineering is a big challenge today. And from my efforts of having taught volunteer efforts of having taught these students, often the key lies in finding the right role models, finding the right mentors, and then structuring the program so that these students can get excited. So often females require different storylines or different hooks just to get excited about building apps or building hacking hardware. For example, I was mentoring a female student last summer, and this was a high school student, and just by getting her excited about what she cared about and structuring the story of our project to what she cared about, where she wanted to make a difference to the world, I was able to get her much more excited and deliver way more on her project. So I think there is a lot of value in finding right role models, right mentors, and structuring the storylines to what these girls care about, like making a difference to the world.
Hi, thank you for the question. I mean, I think there's been a lot of effort lately in increasing STEM, the presence of women across STEM. And what's really remarkable, if you look at the statistics, is that the numbers are going up in pretty much every field except computing, where they're going down. It's really discouraging if you look at the numbers. There was a big peak in the number of undergraduates in around the mid 80s, and it's really come straight down. For men, there were two peaks, so it's come down a little bit for men. But the second peak was during the dot-com boom, and that didn't really give a peak to the number of women undergraduates. And if you look at the workforce, the percentages again, they were 35% women in computing professionals, and it went down to 26% where it is now, which is the same as like the 1960s or something. So it's just really remarkable how computing isn't being affected. And I think that, you know, as part of the problem, I think, you know, whenever I think about women in the computing workforce, you think that, well, of course there aren't a lot. This is an effect of not having that many women in undergraduate, in high school, and so forth that are interested in these subjects. And so I think of it as cause and effect from academia to industry, but I think it goes the other way. I think you have undergraduates coming in, and what you see in the news right now about women in computing fields, the things that are broadcast the most are women being discriminated against, and that is really sending an unfortunate message right now. So I think right now, if you look at, I was just looking up statistics because of this panel, and 0.3% of freshmen women declare computer science as their major, which is down from something like 4.2. That's a huge decrease. The good news is that I think a lot of academia has figured out that they need to make multiple entry points to get women in. So those percentages of 2% of the men and 0.3% of the women going into this freshman year, it changes later on. So I think that, you know, for the those are the people who are the diehard programmers. So I think there are things that people are figuring out in order to get more women in, possibly at later stages, possibly by creating more diverse degrees that combine with biology, that combine with high-performance computing, the efforts that Ellen and colleagues have been doing in computing for good, I think these things are helping level the playing field and bringing more men and women in.
Go ahead. I guess maybe I'll just say a little bit more about this Computing for Social Good, and it has some companion programs, including a summer internship program called Data Science for Social Good. So this is something we got started more than 6 years ago now in the College of Computing, and has gotten a lot of great support from deans past and present to help make it possible. And students work in teams on projects that come from partners in the community. These are often nonprofits who are on the front lines of trying to address pressing social problems. And we give students a chance to both learn teamwork, learn how to talk to a customer, especially how to talk to a non-technical customer, how to iterate on a design idea, and how to turn over something that can be sustained. And that's incredibly important, because otherwise, you know, you build something and then it sits on the shelf. And we haven't tracked carefully, although we certainly could go back and do that, the extent to which this particular class appeals to female students in comparison to similar classes where the projects don't come from the kind of social good domain. My intuition is, and my having taught it many times, is that it does have a disproportionate appeal to female students. I also think it helps paint the picture that the ways that computing can be useful and the reasons to learn it and what you might turn around and do with it are much broader than the things that tend to be particularly visible. And perhaps these days many of those are in the gaming and entertainment businesses. Not that there's anything wrong with those, but it helps students to see, even while they're students, that the applicability of computing is really much, much broader than what may be immediately visible.
First question has to do with the fact that computing is becoming more central to an awful lot of the STEM disciplines now. You know, we hear computational linguistics, we hear about computational biology. Is it possible that there are more women moving in the direction of other disciplines that use computing, as opposed to being focused on the sort of core infrastructure of computing itself? And so it may very well be that maybe we shouldn't panic too much if in fact women are moving into these other disciplines and bringing capability and interest in the use of computing. So this is not quite the same as they've run away from computing. Instead, they've run towards its application. So I don't know this for a fact, but it would be interesting to get some statistics. The other thing that I wonder about your opinion is, I think that it would be very useful if all students were exposed to a required course in programming before they leave high school. And the purpose here is not because I want everyone to be a programmer, but I would like people in the general public to have been exposed to what software is about, to know something about how hard it is to write it, to know something about how hard it is to find bugs in it, to be prepared to understand that software doesn't always work, and so to anticipate that the increasing number of things and services that they rely upon are made out of this ethereal stuff called software, and that they should be prepared for the possibility that it doesn't work as advertised. And I think that would be, also it teaches you a certain kind of thinking, because you have to disarticulate a problem and figure out, how do I get this stupid computer to do what I want it to do? All of that feels to me like it would be a useful skill to have been exposed to, but I'm really interested to know whether my colleagues agree with that.
I will comment on the second part. I think one of the key learning pieces that I've had through my effort of supervising two high school interns last year was that exposing them not just to programming, but to how to think about programming by building an actual project. So a project-based class really helps them realize how much value there is in computing and what can they do with it and why it is hard. Because often the assignments that you get in class are very object-oriented, and they don't make them think as much.
So make them harder. Make them more harder. Ma-
to make them work on projects that they get excited about, to sort of give them a choice of projects. And I think that's really useful from my experience.
You know, I kind of want to quickly say something that addresses both of your questions, which is if you look at computing professionals, I don't know how that's calculated, but that also is a very small percentage and it's going down. But presumably it would include computational blanks, you know, so in these other fields. But I think that part of the problem is that we do a very bad job as a community of advertising what computer science is. It should be explained as problem solving. Every field needs problem solvers, and these are skills that are going to translate. I think that, you know, a lot of times telling students that, you know, learn the skills and later on all your other talents are going to come in and help you. This is something that I tell female graduate students all the time. You have to succeed in the pure stuff, but later on your interpersonal skills, all these other things that are important to you, changing society, they're all going to kick in once you leave graduate school. But right now you sort of have to just buckle down and do the hard stuff. And that's another message that needs to get across. But we need to do a better job of drawing people in by making it more broad and more attractive.
I think one of the biggest impediments to the every high school kid takes a computing class is the availability or lack thereof in the instructors. And we've done some things about that in Georgia, partnership with the College of Computing and the state, to try to train more teachers to be capable of teaching computer science classes in the undergraduate curriculum, in the high school curriculum. And also trying to make moves such as allowing computer science to count as a foreign language? I mean, there's all kinds of creative things being done to try to overcome the, frankly, the public school education system. And so, you know, those are really backdoor kinds of ways to try to get at this, and a company like Google might have a little more power to make something happen. Maybe someone in the audience wants to either comment or offer a path.
Back and watched the exodus after Vince's talk. Over 95% of the women that were here left, and we bemoan the diversity problem we have. Can anybody explain that?
It's because I was a lousy speaker and they didn't want any more of that.
I wanted to add one more thing. So one of the models that Microsoft has tried, and perhaps every technology company can try, is that they're allowing software developers inside the company to volunteer at the high school during their normal hours 2 days a week and go teach. And they have made that as something called a STEALS program, but they're basically getting a mass set of software developers to just go and teach while still doing their normal, regular job. And these people are not getting high school jobs per se, but they're just using this as a second volunteer effort, and they can make it count towards their hours at work.
So it may be true that 95% of the women left, but 98% of the men left. And it's not the women's responsibility to stay in the audience for panels like this. It's gratifying to see women in the audience, but frankly, many of them have probably heard a lot of these messages before. So the, and I'm not that you were implying that was I don't know, their responsibility to stay, but many men left, Right, so that's why we're panelists are up here. A selected number of the audience who didn't leave and who had signed up to be on the panel. I mean, I'm sure all three of us have experienced a a variety of issues over our careers. I remember I took an electrical engineering class. I was a double major in computer science and electrical engineering as an undergrad. Computer engineering didn't really exist at that time. It was in the mid-1980s. Around the time of the first boom of women, actually, female students in computer science programs. And I took a signals and systems class. This is a classic electrical engineering undergrad. The red book, I can't remember the author's name, but someone in the audience probably knows it. And the professor, and it was the first class I took where I was the only female student. And the professor had this habit that he would address the students, he would call on people by their last name. And what he did was he had a piece of paper that had the whole class roll on it. And what he would do is he would say, Mr., and then he would start scanning the last names before he decided to pick one. So it took a while before I went from being Mr. Witty to Miss Witty or Ms. Witty or something like that. I'm sure members of the audience have experiences to share. Of course, we have experiences to share as well. And I think, but important is that everyone view the interest in increasing the representation of underrepresented minorities in computing as something that we all can contribute to, and that we all, have a stake in. And you know, even if you have a hard time with certain types of arguments, you know, the simple, simply looking at the demand in industry for computing professionals, and where is that? How is that demand going to be met? How will the U.S. If you take a U.S.-centric view, how will the U.S. meet that demand when we have such declines in the percentage of women who are pursuing these fields?
By the way, Google hired 10,000 people last year. I mean, in terms of, that's a lot of people, and a lot of them were engineers. Richard DeMillo is here, and with your permission,
sure.
Madam, what do you call it, moderator?
Moderator.
Yes. I'd like to ask Richard to comment on what Ellen said. She said the problem was finding qualified people to teach good quality computer science. And in a discussion with Richard earlier, he pointed out that productivity is the key to reducing cost. So Richard, maybe you could, if you don't mind, come on up here and opine on this question. Could we get good quality teachers in MOOC-like settings in order to get to a larger population of students, make it more affordable to get the really good quality people in front of the students? So Richard is a fixture here at Georgia Tech for quite some time.
I'm sure everybody knows that MOOC is massive online open courses. Yeah.
So I'm one of the ghosts of deanships past that Ellen. Oh my! So we're balanced now. So let me derail that question just a bit, because I did have a comment to make about the issue that Ellen was mentioning and Dana too. So having been through this process of worrying about the number of women undergraduates in computer science at Georgia Tech, and sort of pushing on parts of the balloon and seeing the effects somewhere else, I had an experience last year that convinced me that we're thinking about the problem as a set of individual problems to be solved instead of a systemic problem. So I spent last year in Doha, Qatar. It's one of those tiny, really rich, maybe the richest of the oil kingdoms in the Persian Gulf, and as some of you know, there's maybe a dozen American universities that have campuses, beautiful campuses in Doha. One of them is Carnegie Mellon University. They enroll maybe 300 undergraduates, mainly in computer science, overwhelmingly I would say, in computer science. So I was invited while I was there to give a speech to the undergraduate. Undergraduates at Carnegie Mellon in Doha. And I walked into the room and I saw a sea of women. And it's hard to miss women in the Middle East because they're all wearing abayas. They're all wearing things. I mean, the guys aren't, but they're, you know, women are out there with their with their traditional dress. And it actually took me a few seconds to recover from this and realize that there's something systemically different about being a computer science major in the Middle East. And I don't think it's easily characterizable, but I think it's worthwhile thinking about in our context. I'll give you, for instance, males in Qatar are largely rich, entitled guys that you don't want to hang out with. They're off driving Mercedes and renting condos in London. They've sort of cleared out of the university system, which is mainly run by a woman. The wife of the former emir, the mother of the current emir, is a woman named Sheikha Al Thani. She's a powerful kind of presence in every room that she enters. But she is the person who runs the Qatar Foundation, and she populates these American institutions somehow with students that get into MIT and Harvard and Georgia Tech after they graduate. So it's clear to me that there's something going on systemically in this part of the world that doesn't happen in the U.S. And it's more than teaching STEM better in high school. It's more than prancing Nobel Prize winners in front of high school seniors and saying, "See, you could be like this." And it's more than explaining better what computer science is. I think somehow it's a combination of a lot of different things, one of which is kind of a clear pathway to a career that's attractive. And my guess is that if we were to kind of strip away all the problems that we're having with women in computer science, it's still a career pathway that's not dominated by women. It's dominated by men, a certain kind of male personality. And until you fix that problem, it's probably not going to matter much what we do at the other end.
Well, thank you for saying that, because that's a great segue to my next question to ask you to comment on, and that is that, let's say you overcome the STEM problem of, if there is such a thing, of lack of skill, and all of these women who are now in Qatar and are getting their degrees who haven't yet hit the workplace, and they hit the workplace is predominantly male, and as one of the things that the recent Ellen Powell case, nobody disputed that the things that she talked about in the workplace actually took place, it's a very hostile, in many cases, environment for women. How do you overcome that? Should women just shrug and say, I gotta learn to have a thick skin, which is, I think, what some women have done in the past? Or how do we get this workplace to be more inviting to women?
You're looking at me.
I am, Vint.
You know, a piece of this is sort of common human decency, and that's respect for everyone. And I think women do not enjoy the level of respect that they deserve in a lot of male environments, and computing being one of them. I've seen more than one woman in computer science classes abandon the discipline because of poor treatment by the other members of the class, male members of the class. And it makes me angry that we allow this to happen and that we don't try to do something about it. But if there is anything systemic, it's social in many respects. And by the way, I think this is not a problem which is exclusively found in computer science classes.
No, it's not.
This is a widespread problem in many cultures. And so we're not talking about quick fixes here. We're talking about social engineering in some sense.
So as a young person who's just graduated 2 years back and already in a workforce, one of the things that I realized very quickly, even in grad school, was that it was important to find community of people who felt similarly. So in the first 2 years of grad school, I saw those issues, but I didn't know how to reconcile with them or what to do about them. But after I got this DARE fellowship, I was working with a whole about 12 fellows who were underrepresented communities, not just women, Latinos, African Americans, and we were helping spread diversity at Stanford. One of the things I realized was that when we sat in a room and brainstormed ways to advocate for diversity or help spread diversity, we shared a lot of common issues. And that helped me identify that I was not the only one. So social, the feeling of abandonment comes from feeling you are the only one experiencing that. So if you can get over that aspect, that really helps. And then the second thing that really helped me was having really strong mentors or champions. So when you experience those negative feelings, you want to be able to have someone champion you saying, you know, all of that is fine, but you prove yourself by doing all these cool things, winning the Young Scholar Award, and you can go further, and I know you have it in you to do it.
Your comments about Doha are very interesting because, of course, you know, Hattie and I were talking about how the computer operators and computer programmers were all women here at one point. And, you know, it sort of evolved to when, for a period, people going into computer science, it was a very solitary and a very competitive field. And, you know, when you have girls at a certain age, who, I don't know, if there's a social difference, you know, that causes some difference, maybe it's women maturing faster, that those are not such appealing. but, you know, my guess is that in Doha, it is less competitive. I mean, you can teach it in a way that doesn't have, like, I'll just say that in the workforce, exactly where you see this kind of decrease is there's something about computer professionals in a lot of these industries that has a real entrepreneurial feel to it. And entrepreneurism is another discipline where women just drop off. So it's compounded. You have both of them working together. So, yeah.
So I thought about that. There you go. And in point of fact, I didn't see any evidence of that. I wish I had like a magic bullet I could point to and say here's why it occurred that way. But they have startup competitions, they have entrepreneurial fairs, they have poster sessions, they have things like this, and the women, as far as I can tell, are as competitive there as they would be in this environment. It's just that there are more of them, and they see a pathway to careers that wouldn't exist in any other place. It's a country with 300,000 citizens, 2.5 million people, 300,000 Qatar passport carrying citizens. Most of these people are destined to successful professional careers no matter what they do. And yet they flow into these disciplines in droves.
I just visited, hang on one. Besides, she's going to call on you, right? Because I'm not in charge. I do have the microphone, though. I just visited the U.S. Military Academy last week, and I met with the faculty that teaches computer science and electrical engineering. And I noticed that we had, what is very satisfying is there are a fair number of women now at the Military Academy. But the woman who is in charge of the computer science curriculum said to me that she was very, very careful to make sure there were at least three women in every class. And apparently, that was a magic number that changed the atmosphere in the class, and it helped. And I was curious to know, I see you're all nodding, so that must be an insight that that would be worth keeping in mind as we structure our classes.
I'll call on Cheryl in just 1 minute. I wanted to pick up on the comment about community, and I think that's a really very wisely identified, because it's something that people can do something about, and you know, you could argue that this three made a community, right? Three students in a class, and so by seeking out and developing networks, even if there aren't too many people and you have to stretch the network far, it can still make quite a difference. I had a fellowship when I was a graduate student that was targeted to women in graduate study, not particular to science or engineering. And that provided a community for me. It turns out that there are problems that grad students face no matter what discipline they're in. And so this idea of being able to build up communities without a lot of other infrastructure and without necessarily having a very large number of people to draw on, I think is a really powerful one. Cheryl, do you want to?
Hi, I'm Cheryl, and I got my master's degree here at Georgia Tech, and I got my undergraduate degree in engineering, computer informational sciences, back in 1988, so right as that peak happened. So for me, I find it very distressing that there's such a decline in computer science with women. It really surprises me, because when I came out, I was in industry for a couple of years, and I actually worked at the ITF, worked with those working groups, and that's the Internet Engineering Task Force. So it's volunteers who get together to help write the standards for protocols. And what I found refreshing about that is though I was female and young at that time, it didn't strike me as a good old boys group. If you came in and showed you knew what you were talking about, then you were readily accepted. And it sounds like that's not quite the situation anymore. And I'm not sure why that happened. And that's distressing. As far as the comment about school and getting STEM in earlier, I think that's absolutely critical. Because I'm here with my middle school, seventh grade daughter. I also have two boys. One's here as a freshman in biomedical engineering. And then I have a junior in high school. The difference between boys and girls, especially at that age when they're young, girls tend to have better executive function earlier. This is why insurance companies make you be 25 to rent a car for males, because it's that frontal lobe. I think if more, seriously, I mean, I have two boys. The executive function is just not the same as it is for my daughter. And I think if girls got exposed to programming earlier, because really programming is taking a complex problem and breaking it down into steps. And I think if more everybody, girls and boys, were exposed to programming in middle school, I think that would open future path for more computer science.
That sounds like an experiment. That sounds like an experiment that we could test, or a hypothesis that we could test.
So I'd like to take it back to the workplace for just a second here, and because we keep coming back to school. But I didn't come up in technology, but I did come up in an era in my career where I did face a fair amount of bias. And what I found is that it is not effective to be one of the guys, that it doesn't work to sort of try to be pals with them and everything, and that it garnered me more respect to be a woman in the workplace who was competent than to try to be one of them. And I don't know if that's part of the problem in the workplaces and it'd be interesting to hear that, but I just think, you know, the telling off-color jokes and all the things that are fairly offensive in the workplace that women find themselves faced with, it doesn't help to go right back at them with it, I don't think. That's my personal opinion. So.
So I noticed there are main idea. One is the problem arises mostly through workplace. The other is the problem is part of the college process, and then it's like a K-12. So I was wondering, from my background, I came from China. I know a Chinese woman job work participation rate is slightly higher than the United States, and also what I found is that part of the workplace thing is probably if you have women dropping out of the create a good workplace, and having women dropping out of the workplace far fewer in countries than there are higher respect, just because the socioeconomic dynamics between men and women. So that was one theory. The other theory is getting more people, getting more women engineers in the college. And the third is from K-12, you have better education, you change the culture. between like male and women, like which job suits them in the future. So in for the panelists, which one, if you think we have a limited resource, we want to devote our attention to the three, what would you think are the most critical one to address?
That is a good question.
Anybody got a shot at that one?
Well, I'll answer. I just want to address like a whole bunch of things, which includes this. So going back to Rich's comment, I think that whatever percentage you have, it's a little bit self-sustaining, not more than a little bit. You know, I think in the workforce, people tend to hire people who look like themselves and the people they see around them, and it's very hard to break out of that. And it's also very hard to recognize implicit bias. So advance, I'm one of the advanced professors, each college has one, and we're working together to try to promote women on the faculty. And we're putting together equity training. We used to call it bias training, but we realized we don't want to train people in bias. But you know, there's Project Implicit is something you could Google. It's at Harvard, and it lets you just see, when you see various terms that have to do with literature or STEM things or whatever, do you associate it more with male or more with female? And you have to respond very quickly. And it's very surprising to see how most of us are biased, and they have the same thing for race, and it's you know, a very fast test to take, but I recommend it. So part of the problem is that people don't realize that they've grown up on these values where if you tell a grade school student now, draw a picture of a computer scientist, it's male. He's male. So I think that changing these cultural things, explicitly training people to recognize when, if you look at, there are all these studies now where you look at identical CVs with a male name and a female name, who gets hired more? And the results are really striking. If you look at letters of recommendation, the terms that are used to describe women versus men, if you look at teaching scores and you look at how that, you know, where the averages are for men and women. So I think that, you know, partially we have to do a better job of interpreting when we see somebody entering the workforce and recognizing, valuing diversity. And it's not clear that people do. I mean, again, something you see in the news frequently recently is in the same conversation, certain people coming from Google, in fact, you know, saying things about how we want to increase diversity, but then saying that, you know, most of the people we hire are friends of the people who are here. So all of these things just perpetuate the same kinds of ratios, and that's what we need to break out of.
Maybe it's because I'm at a university, but I tend to think the university is a great place to try to work on this, because it's certainly, there are people who enter the university whose preparation is not sufficient to, for instance, be in computing or engineering. But for the most part, many, many students that enter the university can transition into, say, a computing program. So that pipeline is, I don't think it's as much an issue of the preparation pipeline as it is the selection pipeline. We also have, as you know, a somewhat protected environment here, and so we have a chance to do things that are a bit different than might be possible across industry. We also have students. They're here to learn. They're learning something about the way the world works. They're learning content. They're learning to think about their value system. So it's sort of a ripe time for having an influence. I find these studies on bias to actually be quite fascinating, and in some ways to make me optimistic. And the reason is, when the because now we have science, and maybe not everyone finds science to be optimistic, but we have data about what's going on, and we have a chance for people who who have no reason to want to imply bias, to have their eyes open to the ways in which we do. We don't mean to, we don't want to, but it's there's some things that are quite hardwired, and being aware of them opens up a possibility to behave differently. So I'm actually, I think the development of science that helps illustrate how easy it can be to have these behaviors is actually promising towards changing behavior.
Yeah, I totally agree.
I just wanted to reflect on something that you mentioned. Google actually has a bias, unconscious bias training program. I've been through it. My staff has been through it. And we were all shocked when we saw how biased our answers were when we thought we were absolutely, you know, equal. We thought everybody is equally capable and everything else. But language really made a big difference. And so we keep reinforcing this point to our employees that they may be suffering from a bias which they can't see, and it's harmful to the company. So I hope other companies pick that up and attempt to do the same kind of training.
So some of the, go ahead.
Yeah, come on up. This feels like one of those testimonial things, right? That's what the internet evangelist enjoys about all this.
Hi, so I'm Dorier. I'm the chair of the IEEE student branch here. And I've observed something fascinating. If you look at, one of the best things about the IEEE in a university setting is that it gives you a chance to meet professional mentors who are some of the most accomplished engineers in your area. Overwhelmingly, those people in the Atlanta section are women. And in fact, I'm incredibly proud of Georgia Tech. This was our 100th year of having an IEEE student branch. The thing I'm most proud of is that in our 101st year, we're going to have a majority female officer board. So I guess my question is you know, we're at an interesting point. Well, all of that's true. In ECE, only 20% of the incoming class is women, and it's a little bit better than that in College of Computing. There are many organizations. The WEC here does an incredible job of providing networking opportunities to women, but it's our job as the student branch, and there's a similar job to be done for Georgia Tech in every workplace where, you know, we started by mentioning that lawsuit. There was some really despicable things going on in that workplace, mm-hmm. And it's up to the workplace to set what's acceptable and what's not in the culture. So we're at a moment where you have a majority of women about to set what's acceptable in the culture here at the IEEE in Georgia Tech. What can we do to make that part of it better so that those 20% of women who came in graduate as electrical or computer engineers or computer scientists?
That's a great story.
Yeah, that's terrific. So why do women make less money when they do brave all these challenges to actually get the degree, to get the skills, and then get out in the workplace? And all the studies show that they make less money job for job, comparable skills. Is it because, as some people would say, they are not willing to put the work in, the long hours, the intensity that men are? Is that, or is that just a myth?
Can we address that previous question first?
Oh, sure.
Can you also?
If I understood what he was saying, he was asking, we're studying this within the IEEE student group here, but how do we get these women who are then going to enter industry for them to be able to set these, like, what's acceptable behavior in industry? Mm-hmm. That's a great question. As Alan pointed out, this is a great area for us to experiment with doing this. That's great. How do we get that to move forward with the graduates?
Good point.
You know, I think it's amazing to hear that. That's fantastic. I think partially this kind of culture and this kind of experience for these women empower them to know how to speak up for themselves more, how to back each other up. I think it creates a culture where, you know, you're recognizing the leadership that could come from other women, and that starts permeating the workforce. So going back to the three being the magic number, I almost disagree. I mean, I think communities of women are incredibly important, but three being the magic number is because it's not one. I mean, that makes a huge difference, you know, just the women saying things and it being dropped until one of the men says it.
You know, and I think that when you have more than one woman, they tend to, you know, you could back each other up, you could come back to the same topic, and you could call people out. I mean, I think it's very hard to advocate for yourself, but it's very easy to advocate for other people. And I certainly find that more often I'm willing to stand up and say, you didn't answer her question, or, you know, she's doing a really good job and it's not being recognized, and so forth. So I think that, you know, having these women going out who know each other, it sort of creates a network for them to stand up about these things. And I, just to address the question about pay, I think that, you know, the statistics that, you know, there really is a science now where people are recognizing that evaluations for women come in differently, and letters are, you know, letters of recommendation use words like team player and compassionate, and for men they say, you know, ambitious, you know. And so I think that we have to be better at learning how to evaluate records for men and women and recognize these biases.
So I was going to make the comment, as a person who has to advocate for myself, sometimes it helps to place myself as a third person when I'm advocating for myself, because I found that as a female, it's harder to, we are trained or wired sometimes in ways where we say that I won't advocate for myself if I'm writing that advocacy statement or recommendation letter where I say this is my self-advocacy statement and I did X, Y, and Z. But when I think of myself as a third person, almost myself as a friend, then I'm making a much stronger statement because I have to make the strongest case possible. So I'm just putting that trick out there of considering yourself as your best friend and then making the case when you are telling your boss or your dean about what you did and why it's so critical.
I'm going to pick up on both of these comments. There are skills that can be learned, and we don't try to teach them in the university, but maybe we should be doing more of that. There's a fantastic book called Women Don't Ask. It's worth reading if you are female. It's worth reading if you are ever going to be a boss. I was the chair of the School of Computer Science for 7 years, and I negotiated with a lot of incoming faculty members for salary. We didn't offer a standard salary to every incoming faculty member. We had sort of a starting point, but there was a decent amount of wiggle room, and that book made me reconsider the way I was negotiating, so as, frankly, not to take advantage of people, and this wasn't only men, only women, actually, not to take too much advantage of people who were not strong negotiators. So it's worth reading. I mean, I think there are skills to learn. Sheryl Sandberg's Lean In has gotten a lot of press, some positive and some negative. But there are some speaking techniques. There are some ways to counter interruptions that you can actually practice and learn to do more effectively. And I think that's a way of putting power in the hands of people rather than, it's a sort of very proactive kind of thing to do. You have to be a little careful if you get too good at this. I've had that experience myself. I spent some time in the dean's cabinet that had three men and myself, and I over time adapted a bit of a different speaking style so I could get a word in edgewise, and then I went to a PTA meeting and I realized that I was, you know, jumping all over everybody, stepping all over everybody else, because it was a very different gender and culture experience. But you can, there are skills to learn, and I think they're well worth learning. They're might be framed as tips, and many people who are successful have figured them out or have adapted a set, but you know what? They can be written down. They're not, it doesn't have to be learned by trial and error, and they can really be quite useful.
Joe?
Yeah, just a quick comment. The last couple of questions are focused on two things. One is pay for women, and the other is workplace conditions. I'm not sold on the idea that these are the reasons why the statistics are the way they are. Because, you know, there are millions of women working, probably billions, in industries where the pay is lower and work is harder. You know, the military, nursing, medicine. You go to the developing world, the women working in agriculture, where, I mean, it's I'm sure they'd all much rather be a computer scientist working at Google than they would what they're actually doing. So if professors at universities such as this do not set ratios such as 40% of women doing computer science, or at least within their class, why, let me rephrase that. If, you know, 3, 4, 5, 10, 20% of the women in your computing classes, so of the students in the computing classes are women, there is no reason to ever hope that the ratios in the industry would be higher than this 20%. The 20? But I mean, if you look at science, I mean, a lot of this has been computer science. I think if you look at STEM in general, there probably are a lot of women out there working in science, right? So so if you have a very specific, if the very specific issues with computer science, maybe you could push that up. But it would have to come from university, which is what effectively sets the ratios higher up. Or am I wrong there?
We don't control the ratio of women in our program. They choose to enter the program or not.
We don't make decisions internally about the percentage of women in the computer science degree program. Georgia Tech admits undergraduates. They attempt to get some greater gender balance. They don't attempt gender balance because that would skew things quite considerably. That is the number percentage of women applying to Georgia Tech versus the percentage, you know, is already not a 50-50 proposition. So the university makes decisions on admissions trying to have some consideration for gender and for underrepresented minorities. But the issue is before, the issue is in the applications and in the interest in computer science coming in the door in the university. It's not something that we're not boxing women out of the degree program within the university.
You know, except that, the percentages in STEM are going up, but they aren't in computing, and I certainly see that. So we have another degree program, which is more human-computer interaction, and a lot of women, the ratio is much better over there. But there is somewhat of a zero-sum game, so we actually see fewer. So, you know, I've taught classes that don't have any women in them. You know, I mean, the numbers are really strikingly bad to me, and we need to do something.
Hi, my name is Jessica, and I'm the vice president of the Undergraduate Women in the College of Computing organization. So I feel that part of our mission should be getting computer science out there to the other women in different majors, because they all have to take a computer science course. So what advice do you have for getting, like, promoting computer science among women across campus, as well as creating community in the College of Computing?
My first reaction is, you gotta find something that they care about, first of all, before you can get them interested in computing. If they aren't interested in computing qua computing, they might be interested in what computing can do for them. And so my first thought would be, find applications that draw you in. I don't know how many physicists have ended up in computing because they discovered that in order to do good physics, they had to learn how to do really good computer, or at least, you know, write good programs, big ones. And eventually they said, gee, this is interesting enough that I want to do this full time. So that would be my first reaction, but I bet we have better ideas coming down from this group.
I actually believe the same as to so one of the girls that I, one of the students that I mentored last year, their comment was entirely, I had to listen and key in into what they were excited about, and they wanted to make a difference in the world. So, and then I changed my project spiel to match that, and then they were excited. So I think it matters a lot.
You know, I think that when you come into a computer science building, especially when there is a predominance of men already, you see Star Trek up on the wall. You see, you know, our freshman course, you know, they teach it and football is mentioned a lot. You know, it's just these kinds of things really need to change in order to make women feel more welcome and, you know, for it to be something that's more appealing to them. And, you know, in terms of the, I mean, this kind of permeates kind of every part of the discussion that we've talked about in all of these different things. It's, you know, should women change and become more like the men? I think we need to embrace that there's actually differences and those could be good things. And, you know, by becoming the men, it's, you know, like, I guess that whenever I hear anything on lean in, part of my response is that some of the men need to lean out, you know, so that we could sort of change the way it's perceived, even with small numbers.
How?
I would just want to make a quick comment to try to follow up on Joe's question. So it's not, from my observation, it's not only like in computer science, but more like the high-paying jobs and also the top managerial jobs are not available to women once they like start work after work or 10 years or 20 years later. So for example, in computer science, it's very easy for you to do be a very good programmer for 10 or 20 years, but after 10 or 20 years, you want to move on to managers, you want to be CEOs like of new companies. So for example, like also to the IEEE, like Georgia Tech IEEE, I was at Stanford, I was a president of Tau Beta Pi. So the year before me, there were only one women officer, like out of around 10 officers. In my year, we tried very hard to get two officers, but in later years, we find out the new president, vice president, and secretary actually like started majority of officers start to get to be a woman, start to be women, but once they graduate, once they work in the workforce, but after like after 10 years, some of them like based on data, some of them start to drop out of the workforce. They are not able to get to the top CEOs, CTOs, those positions. I was wondering if there's any way we can do that, like by creating, because people are gonna hire like-minded person, like CEOs probably want to hire a male CTO. Like, how can we get more women to be the CEOs of those companies?
I was going to comment that we should get women to start more companies, and then automatically they'll be CEO, because that's very obvious.
David.
I was going to say the same thing.
David.
David Payne.
Mr. Chairman.
Thanks. I just thought I might like to share a few things from an international perspective, since, first of all, I'm from the UK and travel an awful lot, because I think of necessity this is a somewhat parochial discussion, being here in the US and also in a famous computer science area. I spend quite a lot of my time going out into schools and in particular trying to catch young people at the age of 12 onwards, because I don't think you're going to fix the problem that we're discussing here, you know, overnight. It's and having thought that one through for myself, I thought, well, you know, the best thing you need to do is go and start to talk to young people at the age of 12. At the time that they make their decisions, and make sure that we also mentor these young people, and I'm not using gender here, I'm talking about young people, right, all the way through. It's interesting when I go into schools and give these talks, the people that stay behind and are most interested are usually the females, because, you know, men are at that age where they want to go play football or whatever. It's the females, so I think I might be making a difference here. I certainly hope so. But I think another observation from a UK perspective is we have just started to talk about discrimination against boys. Because in some professions, we're now beginning to see as much as 80% female, in particular the biomedical sciences, medicine, veterinary science, and these kinds of areas. And I think if you try to follow that logic through, you wonder whether there doesn't need to be some sort of negotiation between the different professions. You know, we won't take any boys. No, no, we won't take girls. But that's interesting. So my final comment also, though, was from the perspective of China, which you've already raised, where my experience has been that you do get a lot of females as engineers. And I wondered why that was. So here's a little anecdote. So I'm working with a team in a very big company at the moment, and they're all females. So there's five of them, really high quality engineers. But the president asked us out one night, and this is a 4,000 person company, right? It's a big company. And we had a usual boozy evening, you know, with lots of Mao Tai and all the rest of it. And I could see the engineering team were all looking a little uncomfortable. It was, you know, a typical male boozy thing. and so I took the opportunity to ask them what had they done with their families whilst this was going on. Because they were kind of all looking at their watches, and you could tell that you know, they had imperatives to be home. And they kind of opened up to me at that point and said, you know, it wasn't easy for them to come out in this male environment and to have this kind of an evening when they had childcare duties. And so I think it's important that we think about, you know, the childcare availability to allow women to do what is, you know, engineering profession often demands, which is, you know, long hours, as a point that's already been made, evenings of networking and so on. And in China, what they said was that the family tended to do it, so they could call on the grandparents and so on that would come in and do that. Or the husband, indeed, would do that. So I think partly this is then, you know, it's a cultural thing. And some cultures possibly deal with it rather better than we do in the West. So how we fix that one, who knows? Comments from anybody that knows how to do that.
We're going to have to make this the last round of comments because we're running late. Anybody in the audience have an answer?
So there also are some alternatives that I think you are worth putting on the table. And those have to do with changing the expectation in the part of companies that to succeed in the job requires evenings and weekends and time away from family. So that changes the landscape in which the competition, should you choose to call it that, takes place between the people who are working there. And I think there are plenty of indications that both men and women would prefer if they could succeed in their career, not at the expense of evenings and weekends with their families. That's, of course, a huge cultural change. I think it's one we have a lot more chance of achieving in the US than having, say, the grandparents living in the home with the family and therefore being readily available babysitters, as is the case in some countries where families remain multi-generational, very, very closely tied together. So that's the only comment I want to make in response.
I just want to end on a slightly higher note than some of my negative comments. And especially, Jessica, is it? Yeah. I mean, especially going back to your comment, I mean, definitely one thing that needs to get out more is that there are lots of jobs. Even more jobs are going to be available. They're high-paying jobs, and a lot of them do have these kinds of things figured out. And so, you know, there are opportunities to find the kinds of jobs that fit whatever lifestyle you want. And I think that with the exploding job market, it's crazy for people not to be moving into computing and recognizing all the opportunities and the diversity of jobs that they could go into afterwards. So that's definitely a message to try to get out to these other young women.
Some company policy like increasing the length
So this is a question about, you know, increasing maternity leave. Actually, we have both maternity and paternity leave at Google, and I think it's at least 6 weeks, and maybe more. That I haven't had children in my family for a long time. I think for sure that was a big issue, and the equality side of it turned out to be just as important. So I think it's made a difference, at least at Google. So I would argue it would probably make a difference elsewhere as well.
I think that's a really good point, that women getting more family-friendly policies actually will benefit men as well as women. There's probably a lot of men out there who would like to spend more time with their families but feel that it's not, can't work in the culture that they're in, but they can change the culture. So thank you very much for being here, and if you have other questions, you can email. Can I give them your email address? Vint@google.com. Your email address?
I'm just used to always being the loudest person in the room, so my email is mylastnamerandall@cc.georgiatech.edu.
And you can Google me and you'll find me, because I'm the only Ellen Zagura on the internet.
Anna Kongcha?
Oh, mine is ac@microsoft.com in case you want to email me. Thank you.